Embroider from zero to route splitting in 3.5 weeks. So a couple months ago now, I went through an effort of porting our app over to Embroider. It took about 3.5 weeks to do the full thing. And I wrote up an article on it afterwards. And most of this talk is kind of adapted from that article. So I'm going to move relatively quickly through the kind of slides and the meat of the information to leave time for questions, because, you know, I could have just brought up my article and read it to you all, but that doesn't seem like the most interesting use of time here. I skipped my greeting. I was going to say greetings from just becoming sunny Seattle. It's not terribly apocalyptically hot out here anymore like it was a couple weeks ago, although it looks like our smoky season might be coming early, and so it might get terribly apocalyptically smoky in a couple weeks. But right now it's beautiful and lovely, and we're all enjoying it while it lasts. Who am I? I'm Ben Demboski. I'm the CTO at Rowan Patents, which is a company that does several different things, but the software portion of it focuses on building software for patent attorneys to help automate their workflows and whatnot. I've used Ember for about 7 years, both professionally and for kind of side projects. And I've learned everything I know about Embroider in the process of porting our app to it. I knew just a tiny bit about it and some theoretical benefits we'd get from it before I dove into it. I'm currently suffering from some amount of imposter syndrome because I'm by no means an Embroider expert, yet here I am, you know, giving a talk about it. More some guy that stumbled his way through the porting and learned a lot in the process. But, you know, I guess that's enough to share to help you all stumble your way through someday, or, you know, maybe by then things will be moved along, that there'll be, you know, more guides and whatnot and less stumbling. And you can find me on Twitter and Discord at Ben Demboski. So, the app that we ported to Embroider, so it's a multi-window Ember Electron desktop app. And think of it kind of like an IDE. That's how we think of it, as an IDE for patent attorneys, except for reasons it makes sense for their productivity to have things in multiple windows rather than just multiple panes within the same window. So the attorney will have multiple windows open with different tool sets in them at the same time that they can cross-reference, and they're syncing data in between them. So a lot of the routes, a lot of our Ember routes are only ever rendered in one window. So loading the entire app in every window would be needlessly memory consumptive. I might have just made up that word, consumptive, needlessly consuming memory. And also, more than just our Ember code, we have a lot of third-party libraries that are only used by code in one window, things to do natural language processing type analysis and that sort of thing. So for us, memory footprint, including code size, is a big concern, because multiple windows multiplies the any code that's loaded in all the windows, you know, gets multiplied by however many windows are open, and it can be a number of windows. And then I spit out some stats on our app, just so if you're trying to, I don't know, compare yours to ours in terms of sizing, maybe the effort or something. So our goal in the porting was to control the code-driven memory footprint with minimal engineering effort, and to do that via tree shaking and route splitting. And when I say tree shaking, I realized after I wrote up these slides that it's more than just tree shaking, but basically, let's just say modern JavaScript bundling techniques for reducing the size of the bundle. And tree shaking is a notable one of those, but there's others as well. We had previously, using Ember auto import and a whole bunch of manual webpack configuration to explicitly strip out code that we didn't need in certain windows and stuff, had achieved a pretty good amount of code-driven memory footprint management, but the minimal engineering effort part was not there. So we were looking for kind of a set it and forget it type solution with minimal ongoing maintenance. So before getting into some of the slightly nittier, grittier my overall impressions of Embroider are more or less the same as they were when I wrote the article, that I would kind of classify it as late stage alpha or early stage beta quality software. So the core functionality is solid. Fairly severe bugs aren't that uncommon still. The documentation is somewhat minimal. Porting a complex app to Embroider can be pretty effort intensive, and keeping it up to date across new releases of Embroider can also be somewhat effort intensive, as it's still in a state where regressions, you know, come up and can require some effort to figure out how to work around them or configure around them. But I did find that production stability is very high. None of those things that keep me up at night of I build it once in CI and then I rebuild with exactly the same code and the production bundle is different. You know, none of that stuff happens. What I've found is that once it's building and I've got it all lined up, it's very stable. It's just as Embroider changes and evolves, that introduces some instability updating to those newer versions. The dev environment stability I've found to be pretty high. It's pretty stable. There's some minor hiccups, nothing that I've found to be a major issue. And I think a lot of that has to do with kind of source map flakiness, which often just refreshing the window a couple times. I'm not sure if that's really Embroider's fault or Webpack's fault or Chrome DevTools' fault. So those are my high-level impressions. So a kind of really oversimplified overview of what Embroider does is it takes your Ember app and assembles it and all of the add-ons into a kind of a vanilla Node.js project that's kind of hidden or already resolved all the unique behaviors of Ember and Ember CLI. So it's run the Broccoli pipeline and gotten all the add-ons to contribute their assets, but then it assembles it into a kind of static Node.js project with the package.json and node modules put in the right place and whatnot, so that then it can point a standard packager like Webpack is the current one that's supported, although they're working on support for some others. But in theory, you should be able to use anything Webpack or Rollup or anything like that. But yeah, it can point Webpack at it. And then with some custom loaders and whatnot, then Webpack turns it into a browser bundle. So one of the big goals is to leverage everything that's been done out in the community on bundlers, rather than Ember having to maintain our own bundler that kind of duplicates a bunch of functionality that the broader community is working. And then the last step is it injects the bundled scripts and other Webpack generated resources back into your index.html using some of those special rules that we have in Ember, where the root URL gets filled in if you're posting on a CDN and that sort of stuff. So that's kind of an overview of what Embroider does. And my reason is to provide some context for some of the hard parts that I found of porting to Embroider. So one of them was the package.json dependencies. When Embroider's assembling the vanilla Node.js version of the application, it relies heavily on information in the apps and add-ons package.json to set things up properly, to know which packages to include in the kind of assembled, you know, vanilla JS package, so that Webpack will do the right thing. And so missing dependencies, but under Ember CLI, it was fine because the package was still in node modules because it was a transitive dependency of some add-on, but your app didn't call it out as a dependency, even though it imported it. That would work in Ember CLI. That would break under Embroider. So there's a bunch of cases where, yeah, we had to do some fiddling with undeclared dependencies or tricks that we'd play with putting something in peer dependencies instead of declaring our own dependency on it. That took some doing to get that all working. Another one is ES6. That might be ES5 module compliance. I can never quite remember the distinction between ES5 and ES6 modules. But the idea is that the Webpack static analysis of the code is based on stricter module resolution rules than Ember's kind of runtime module loader or the way the code gets transpiled into runtime modules. So a lot of slightly incorrect imports. For example, I think this one isn't actually a problem, but the example of the sort of thing I'm talking about is if a module has a bunch of named exports, and you consume it by importing a single default export and then accessing the named exports as properties on the default export, that's not actually correct because the module isn't producing a default export. It's only producing named exports. I think Webpack might just give a warning on that one, but that's the sort of issue that we ran into in a number of places where just imports weren't quite right. Then statically analyzable components. So there's a whole section in the Embroider readmes on kind of how to deal with it. But, you know, sometimes a number, we use the component helper and can play a little fast and loose where maybe one component gets passed an argument that's the name of another component and then internally uses the component helper to invoke that component. And when moving to the optimized Embroider settings, so by default, there's a baseline of Embroider settings, but to get to a bunch of optimizations, including route splitting, you need to enable a higher bar of settings that allows Embroider to do more static analysis. And one of those is components, so that Embroider can understand. Part of it is being able to tree shake components, being able to look through the templates and see what components are and aren't referenced, so that it can leave out components that actually aren't referenced anywhere, you know, in an add-on, for example. So it definitely took some fiddling because there were places where we were playing little tricks with how we kind of dynamically invoked components that needed to clean up. CSS and SAS, like I say in the article, unfortunately, I didn't keep notes on that when I was doing it, so I can't quite recall exactly what the issues were there, but there was enough differences between how Ember CLI kind of assembles CSS and Embroider assembles CSS that we ran into some styling issues and had to shuffle some things around. And then the big one was third-party add-ons, because all those things that I just listed, when they're directly under my control in my code, I can go in and fix them. Third-party add-ons is, you know, I can't just fix it immediately. So in some cases, contributing fixes. In other cases, finding workarounds through Webpack configs or Embroider configs to address all of those previous issues, but in the context of third-party add-ons. And over in the article that I linked to at the beginning of the presentation, I actually list out all the major ones that required effort and explain what was needed. That's probably a little obsolete now because I know at least one or two of those have been addressed since I wrote the article, but that can give you a sense of the kinds of challenges that you've run into and then also maybe flag some specific add-ons that you might, you know, use that are problematic. Fortunately, I mentioned all the workarounds for the problems that I ran into. So hopefully that'll help some folks out. Kind of this is my last slide before we, you know, turn it over to Q&A, but my experience getting support. So I found that the Dev Embroider Discord channel was pretty helpful. There's folks hanging out there that can share their experiences and answer questions. Some of the kind of core drivers of Embroider, you know, Ed Faulkner and, you know, and Rob Jackson are there, you know, but they're busy folks. So can't reliably, you know, get support directly from them. But the channel, but they do pop in and out and answer questions. And so the channel is, I found, was pretty helpful. I found that bugs don't always get addressed very quickly because, again, I think there's just a lot that's still being done on it. But I found that pull requests get attention pretty quickly and it's relatively easy to get some support from Ed or from, you know, other folks in terms of shepherding PRs through. Yeah, like I mentioned, the core team was pretty helpful in providing advice for investigating and fixing bugs. And I found that the Embroider code base itself, as far as diving in to just investigate and figure out how to work around something or contribute back a fix, the Embroider code base looks kind of intimidating. It isn't too terribly hard to kind of dig into and investigate issues once, you know, a little bit of time getting comfortable with where the pieces are. But then my experience with the code base was pretty positive. And I did manage to contribute a few fixes back for issues that I was running into. So that's all that I had presentation wise. And like I said, I wanted to save time for any questions that folks have. So I'll open the floor to questions.